Good evening. We'd like to call the Durham City Council meeting to order at 7:04 p.m. Certainly want to welcome all of you that are here with us this evening. If we could take a moment of solemn meditation, please. Thank you. Ask Councilman Brown if he would lead us in the pledge.
All rise. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Clerk, will you call the roll, please? Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden.
Present.
Councilmember Brown.
Here.
Councilmember Cotati.
Here.
Councilmember Davis.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
And Councilmember Shule.
We have one proclamation that we'd like to present this evening, National Disability Employment Awareness Month proclamation. I presented to Jason Jones, who's the Assistant Director of Durham Parks and Recreation, and Morris Clemens, Chairman of the Mayor's Committee on Persons with Disabilities, and Deborah Giles, the Director of Equal Opportunity Equity Assurance. And the proclamation reads, whereas the month of October has been designated by the United States Congress as National Disability Employment Awareness Month, whereas 2015 is the seventh year of this designation, whereas the 2015 theme is, my disability is one part of who I am, whereas Americans with Disability Acts of 1990 and Washington Law Against Discrimination promote independence, empowerment, and quality of life, whereas workplaces welcoming of the talent of all people, including people with disabilities, are a critical part of our efforts to build an inclusive community and strong economy, whereas we consistently work to break down barriers and work together to ensure that people with disabilities can participate fully in the workplace and all aspects of community life, whereas we must continue to work for a community where all individuals are respected for who they are, celebrated for their abilities, and encouraged to realize their full potential and achieve their dreams, whereas the City of Durham celebrates National Disability Employment Awareness Month through numerous events, including Disabled, the Label, and an Employee Recognition Program hosted by the Mayor's Committee for Persons with Disabilities to honor employees who hire persons with disabilities. Now, therefore, I, William V. Bill Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, North Carolina, do hereby proclaim October 2015 as National Disability Employment Awareness Month in Durham, and hereby urge all to take special note of this observance by joining together and reaffirming our determination to achieve a society that affords independence, justice, and dignity for all. Witness my hand, Corporate Seal of the City of Durham, North Carolina. This is the 21st day of September 2015. I'm going to present this to Jason and any comments that you might have.
I sure do.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mayor Bell and City Council, for this proclamation. I'd like to recognize several of our key partners, and as I call your names, just stand up if you're in the audience. The Mayor's Committee on Disabilities, the Equal Opportunity Equity Assurance Department, the Office of Economic and Workforce Development, the Goodwill Community Foundation, the Disabled the Label Planning Committee, and North Carolina Central University's Office of Student Disability Services. I'd also like to recognize a part of DPR's Special Programs Inclusion and Mature Adults team, Sarah Hogan, Recreation Manager, Joel Smith, a Recreation Supervisor, and Abby Walls, Recreation Assistant Supervisor. I'd also like to recognize Marge Clemens as a member of our Recreation Advisory Committee. To celebrate this month, we invite each of you to join us for Disable the Label to be held on Saturday, October 3rd from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the Holton Career and Resource Center. Moving forward, our department is working on a new strategic plan. Within that plan, we're working on a new mission statement, and our current working version includes connecting our whole community. This year's theme of My Disability is One Part of Who I Am means to me one part of a whole person that we're proud to serve and work alongside within Parks and Recreation, within the Parks and Recreation part of our whole community. Thank you.
comments by members of the council? If not, recognize the... Many of you may know that the council has been, and the administration has been, very involved in working to bring affordable housing units to this community. And when we speak about affordable housing, we're speaking about houses that are affordable to families that are below the area median income. And towards that end, we've worked on several projects. Probably the one that's most recent is the one we want to recognize this evening. It's a home ownership program over on the south side. And the success of the city's neighborhood revitalization efforts in Southside has shown there's a demand for home ownership in this very historic neighborhood. The experience of attracting buyers for phase one of the ownership component of the Southside project showed a very strong interest by many families in Durham wanting to buy a home of their own, but also showed many households were not positioned to meet lenders' underwriting requirements at initial application. In other words, they were not what we call mortgage ready. And the city is determined to get in front of phase two home ownership development by launching a marketing initiative that will focus on helping households be pre-qualified to qualify for a mortgage when the next houses in the ownership neighborhood began to be built in late 2016. Now, the neighborhood that I'm speaking about, as I said, is over on South Side. And if any of you have an opportunity to ride over on South Street in that area, you'll see a transformation that's taking place. And part of the transformation is the home ownership piece, where I think all the homes there have been either bought or accounted for, and we're going into phase two. And we want to make sure that we reach as many persons as possible, at least to get the message out, that there's an opportunity to become a homeowner in this area. And towards that effort, we're trying to prepare a strategy that will be supported by individualized housing counseling for families with the income capacity and desire to own a home through the Department of Community Development at no cost to these families. What you're going to see in a couple of minutes is that Time Warner Cable provides for TV commercials and video and mobile impressions online. The advertisements we've seen on HGTV, OWN Network, TWCE News, 14 BET, and Durham Television Network. And we would all like to thank the volunteers, the theater majors from NCCU, and their department director, who were very instrumental in making the video that you're about to see. So I guess what I should say now is roll the video.
Home ownership. It may be closer than you think. Are you ready? You may be eligible to take advantage of home ownership programs through the city of Durham. If you have a moderate household income, you may be eligible to purchase a new home in the downtown neighborhood of Southside. Homes will begin to be available the summer of 2016. Now is the time to get your finances in shape. Housing counselors are standing by to go over details and help you understand the process of buying your own home. Contact the Department of Community Development and take your first steps to home ownership.
Now, let me acknowledge the volunteer theater department students from NCCU. Is Chase Rivers here? Is Chase here? Stand up if you don't mind. Jonathan Abel. Is Jonathan present? Great. And the chair of the NCCU theater department, Dr. Asabi Stephanie Howard. Well, we certainly appreciate the time that you've taken to help develop this video. I think it's going to be very helpful as we move into phase two, and I would encourage all of you to tell friends or families or anyone that has an interest in becoming a homeowner in the Southside area to please contact the Community Development Department. I guess that's the first place to start. I don't have a telephone number right off of it. Is Reggie Johnson here? What is the telephone number? Reginald Johnson is here, who's the director of Community Development Department.
Thank you, Mayor. Reginald Johnson, Department of Community Development Director. The number is 919-560-4570.
Okay, let's move to any comments that members of the council may have. And I didn't hear any comments, so I recognize the city manager. I'm sorry, Edwin. Okay. Recognize the city manager for priority items.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, everyone. No priority items.
Likewise, recognize the city attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No priority items.
And likewise, the city clerk.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, we have with us this evening Barry Birch Sr., who was recently appointed to the Citizens Advisory Committee. He's here to be sworn in before the City Council.
Well, you do the honors.
I, Barry Birch Sr.
I, Barry Birch Sr.
do hereby solemnly swear.
Do hereby solemnly swear.
That I will support and maintain the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and maintain the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution and laws of North Carolina.
And the Constitution and laws of North Carolina.
Not inconsistent therewith.
Not inconsistent therewith.
And that I will faithfully and impartially.
And there I will faithfully and impartially.
Discharge the duties of my office.
Discharge the duties of my office.
As a member of the Citizens Advisory Committee.
As a member of the Citizen Advisory Committee.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Agenda is, you know, the agenda consists of a consent agenda which may be approved with a single motion and a vote by the council unless an item is removed by someone in the audience or even a member of the council. And at that point, we discuss it later in the program. I read the headings of each one of the consent agenda items. Item one is approval of City Council minutes. Item two is inventory audit, June 2015. Item three is the street renaming Ridgeway Road, SN 1500002 and SN 1500003. Item four is the First Amendment to the parking lease agreement by and between the City of Durham and American Campus LLC for the North Parking Garage. Item six is professional engineering services for the Homeland Avenue Stream Relocation Project. Item seven is professional engineering services for the Aiken Avenue Stream Relocation Project. Item eight is professional engineering services for roof replacements at various Department of Water Management facilities. Item nine is disparity study follow-up report. Item 10 is the contract for insurance broker services. Item 11 is the contract for false alarm reduction program services. Item 12 is land lease between the City of Durham and Frontier Communications of the Carolinas, LLC. Item 13 is proposed condemnation of property located at 1914 East Cornwallis Road, parcel ID 155777, and 1916 East Cornwallis Road, parcel ID 155776, for the Martin Luther King Jr. Sanitary Sewer Outfall Relocation Project. Item 14 is proposed conveyance of various property interests in the North Carolina Department of Transportation for the Austin Avenue Widening Project. Item 15 is proposed conveyance of city-owned property to the North Carolina Department of Transportation for the Austin Avenue Widening Project. Item 16 is a contract for open data platform. And items 20 through 26 are items that can be found on the general business agenda as public hearings. I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda. Second. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
We move to the general business agenda for public hearings. Item 20 is consolidated annexation 729 Clawson Drive, BDG 1500003.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Pat Young with the planning department. This request represents a consolidated annexation item for a property located at 729 Clawson Road, which includes initial zoning, annexation, and approval of utility extension agreement. Staff recommends an initial zoning of this case of RS Residential Suburban 20, also in the FJB Falls of the Neuse, the Jordan Lake B watershed. This recommendation was unanimously recommended by the Planning Commission at their meeting of April 14, 2015. Public Works and Water Management Departments performed the required utility impact analysis and determined that the existing City of Durham's sanitary sewer and water mains in this area have capacity for the proposed development. Budget Management Services Department coordinated a fiscal impact analysis which determined that annexation of this property would be revenue positive following annexation. Staff recommends approval. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Any You've heard the staff report. This is a public hearing. I would ask, are there comments first by members of the council with regard to the staff report? If not, I would ask, is there anyone in the audience that wants to speak on this item? I do have one person that has signed up to speak. I think it's Mitch Barrow or Barron. Is it, before you begin, is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item? If not, you have 3 minutes.
Mayor Bell and council members, just ask for your favorable vote on this. I have requested this annexation so that I can tie into the city water line that's actually already existing on this lot. And just hoping the annexation goes through, and appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other questions, comments? Anyone else want to speak? If not, let the record reflect that no one else asked to speak. I'll declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council.
Move the item.
Second.
Recognize Councilman Moffitt.
I need to raise the question. I understand that the applicant wants to tie into city water and sewer, and I'm all in support of that. But I do want to ask if annex, I want to at least force for a moment to examine whether or not in this particular case, I understand our policy to be that if you want to tie to city sewer and water, you must present a voluntary, an application for voluntary annexation. In this particular case, I'm thinking about emergency services and the fact that this will be one lot in a large area of county, and whether or not annexation makes sense. I'm all in favor of extending water and sewer, but, and I don't know if there's anybody that can even speak. Okay, good, thanks.
Staff can address that. Councilman Moffitt, it's something we've discussed internally, and there's a follow-up, a piece of information may be helpful.
Thank you, Mr. Manager, Councilman Moffitt, and council members. We certainly appreciate the concern, and we as the manager alluded to, he raised that concern with us during preparation of the staff report. And what we advise the manager and what we'll tell you now is that there's a pending annexation application for property immediately to the north along Dulaire Drive that would make this proposed annexation directly contiguous with the city. And then there's several other properties that we believe over time will become annexed and make this part of a contiguous stretch of city area. Now, that may not happen immediately, but the like I said, the adjacent annexation is pending and will be before you within the next several months.
I appreciate Don asking that. I was wondering about that myself, except that my question was, how confident are you? I saw that in the memo, I think December is the date for these proposed annexations, and we're feeling comfortable about that.
Yes, sir, Councilman Shull. So the annexations are effective four times a year. The next annexation date would be December 30th after the coming one. And so, yes, I'm confident that the adjacent properties will come before you prior to December 30th and be able to be affected by then. So by January 1st, you'll have adjacent and contiguous city property to the east.
And I just want to note the sewer is actually county sewer that's already existing. Is that right?
That's correct. It's city water, county sewer in this location.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Any further questions, comments? If not, the public hearing has been closed. Matters back before the council. It's been moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? You close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Next item is item 21, consolidated annexation. The Harris. I'm sorry.
Consistency statement.
Thank you.
Brought and moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? You close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We move to item 21, consolidated annexation, Harris Beverage, BDG 15-00009.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, Pat Young again with the planning department. First, let me certify for the record that the previous case and all subsequent cases have been advertised in accordance with requirements of law. There are affidavits to that effect on file with the planning department. This case, item 21, Hoven Group 4 has submitted a consolidated annexation item for approximately 21.5 acres of land at 1035 Junction Road. And this item before you includes initial zoning, annexation, and approval of utility extension agreement. The subject site is currently vacant. If approved, the applicant intends to construct a warehouse on the annexed portion of the property. Staff is recommending initial zoning of IL, or industrial light, and FJB watershed. This is an exact translation of the current zoning in Durham County and at the request of the applicant. and it is consistent with the comprehensive plan. Public Works and Water Management have performed the required utility extension, utility impact analysis, and have determined that the existing city sewer and water capacity at this location is adequate for the proposed development. And Budget Management Services performed a fiscal impact analysis determining that if approved, the proposed annexation will be revenue positive following annexation. Staff recommends approval. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Recognize Councilman Shule.
There are no Planning Commission comments. Mr. Young, is that true?
Mr. Shule, this did not go to Planning Commission because it's a direct translation from county zoning, and there's a standing policy from about 10 years ago from the Planning Commission that allows them to automatically endorse direct translational zoning.
Great. I saw the resolution, but I wasn't sure how that was connected, but I appreciate that. I understand. Thank you.
Any other comments, questions by the council? Again, this is a public hearing. I have one person that signed up to speak. I want to know if there's anyone else that wants to speak on this item, this being a public hearing matter. If not, recognize Patrick Biker for 3 minutes.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of the City Council. My name is Patrick Biker. I live at 2614 Stewart Drive. I'm an attorney with Morningstar Law Group. I'm here tonight representing Harris Beverages in regards to this annexation. Jay Harris, the president of Harris Beverages, regrets that he couldn't be here. He's out of town on a business trip. Just for the record, want to thank all the city departments who have helped us with this project. We look forward to having a new headquarters and warehouse facility developed out in East Durham by middle of next year. I'd be happy to answer any questions the council may have, and we respectfully ask for your support. Thank you.
You've heard the developer's representative. Do you have any questions, comments? If not, no one else in the public wanted to speak on this item. Let the record reflect that. And public hearing is closed. Matter back before the council.
Second.
Been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Move to item 22, consolidated annexation. I'm sorry, the consistency statement. Yeah. We had a motion and a second. Okay, we'll open the vote. And close the vote.
7-0.
All right, move to item 22, consolidated annexation, Montessori School of Raleigh, BDG 1400011.
Good evening again, Mr. Mayor, members of council, Pat Young with the Planning Department. This item is a consolidated annexation item submitted by Montessori School of Raleigh. Involves two parcels of land on Andrews Chapel Road, totaling approximately 39.7 acres. And this item includes initial zoning, annexation, and approval of the utility extension agreement. At this site, there's an existing educational facility approved in 2011. No expansion to the present use is proposed at this time. Staff recommends an initial zoning of rural residential, which is consistent with the City Council policy designating the least intense zoning district based on the development tier. Also consistent with the existing zoning on the site. Public Works and Water Management have performed the required utility impact analysis and have determined that there's existing capacity in the water and sewer systems at this location, and Budget Management Services performed the required fiscal impact analysis, determining that this project would be revenue negative based on the fact that it's there's an educational exemption from sales and property tax on this property unless it was redeveloped. Staff recommends approval of the item, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Again, it's a public hearing. You've heard the staff report. I would ask other questions by members of the council. If not, is there anyone in the public wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect that no one in the public asked to speak on this item. I would declare the public hearing to be closed and matters back before the council. Recognize Councilman Shule.
My comment is they need to change the name of this school to Montessori School of Durham. They're totally in Durham, and they could be improving their image.
Any other comments? If not, Madam Clerk, will you open the vote?
We need a motion.
Second.
Will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. The next item is item 23,
Consolidated Annexation Americo, BDG 15000001.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Pat Young again with the Planning Department. Americo Real Estate Company is requesting a consolidated annexation item for five parcels of land totaling approximately 6.01 acres at 2470 West U.S. Highway 70. And this includes initial zoning, annexation, and utility extension agreement. The applicant intends to expand and upgrade an existing U-Haul rental business at this site. Staff recommends initial zoning of commercial general CG and residential suburban 20. This is an exact translation of the existing counting zoning and is consistent with the comprehensive plan designation of this site as commercial. The proposed development has been reviewed by Public Works and Water Management for utility impact analysis and determined that there are sufficient capacity for water service at the site. The sewer service is actually provided by Durham County at this location. Budget Management Services performed a fiscal impact analysis, which determines that the revenue from this project will be positive following annexation. Staff recommends approval, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Again, this is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. Would ask other questions by members of the council of the staff report. Is there anyone in the audience that wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect no one in the audience wanted to speak on this item. I'll declare the public hearing to be closed. Matter back before council. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote and close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
Come on. Who's going to move the consistency statement? Okay. It's been properly moved and second. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote and close the vote?
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Item 24, zoning map change, Southwest Durham at 15501, Z14000030.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Pat Young again with the Planning Department. This request is a request by the Arden Group to change the zoning map designation of approximately 12.45 acres of property at 3301 Southwest Durham Drive, which is at the intersection of US 15501 and Southwest Durham Drive, southeast quadrant, from its current zoning map designation of residential suburban 20 or RS20. To commercial general with a development plan or CGD. This request is consistent with the future land use map designation for the property, which is commercial. The proposal before you includes a number of commitments which exceed minimum ordinance standards, including provision of a shared use bicycle pedestrian trail and a bus shelter and pullout, along with a number of other transportation related improvements which are detailed in the staff report for this item. As I believe you're aware, there were significant changes made to the staff report late on Friday that were pursuant to a correspondence received from the North Carolina Department of Transportation on that same date on Friday afternoon, September 18th. That's referenced as attachment 22 in the revised staff report. Based on the correspondence from NCDOT, staff was able to determine compliance with a number of transportation-related policies of the comprehensive plan and UDO as identified in your staff report. The Planning Commission did not have that information at the time of their hearing on August 11th. They recommended approval by a vote of 8-6. And staff finds that this request is consistent with all adopted plans, policies, and ordinances, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Are there questions by members of the council? This is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. If not, we have four persons that have signed up to speak. If you haven't signed the card, is anyone else that wants to speak that has not signed the card? And I might indicate that all four indicated they want to speak in support of this item. So is anyone that wants to add their support? Is anyone that wants to speak in opposition to it? Okay, so we'll go with the four people that have signed up to speak, and each one has 3 minutes. As I call your name, you can come to the podium to the right. Patrick Biker, John Davenport, Tony Fisher, and Michael Waldrop. In that order.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden, members of the City Council. My name is Patrick Biker. I still live at 2614 Stewart Drive, and I'm an attorney in Durham with Morningstar Law Group. I'm here tonight representing University Ford. We are requesting your approval of this zoning map change on 15501 at Southwest Durham Drive. Our team that is here tonight includes John Davenport, our traffic engineer, Dan Jewell, our landscape architect, and Tony Fisher, the president of University Ford. At the outset, I think it is vitally important for the council to address a threshold issue, which is, does the city council wish for University Ford to remain at its current location for the next 20 or 25 years, or does the council wish for University Ford to relocate to this site on 15501? University Ford has been at its downtown location for over 40 years. In short, they were downtown before downtown was cool. Now, after more than 40 years, University Ford either must spend several million dollars to upgrade its current facility, or it has to relocate pursuant to this rezoning that's before you tonight. University Ford's strong preference is to relocate to this site on 15501. We respectfully submit that this relocation is in the city's best interest as well. University Ford's relocation will allow downtown Durham to continue its strong growth and bring new jobs and new residents to our downtown core. Approval of this rezoning will stimulate a significant tax base increase for the city, far above the current $6.5 million of assessed value for University Ford. Of course, with every commercial rezoning come transportation concerns. We think that the overarching concern in this case is the dedication of right-of-way at the intersection to accommodate the improvement of 15501 to a freeway. On page 16 of the revised staff report, it states that 15501 has a capacity of 62,900 cars, and today it carries 46,000 cars. In other words, 15501 is operating at less than two-thirds of its capacity. Given that traffic volumes on 15501 are significantly under capacity, I think it is safe to say it will not be upgraded to a freeway anytime soon, and it is probably at least 15 to 20 years out. I am confident that our team, spearheaded by John Davenport, has addressed the right-of-way issue correctly. Also, given the status of improvements to 15501 as unfunded, we researched any potential liability the city could have, and I shared that research with the city attorney. I am not aware of any statutory or case law basis for the city to have liability for the future acquisition of right-of-way from University Ford. I close with that point about right-of-way because that's the key transportation issue before the council this evening. And now to discuss these right-of-way issues and related transportation issues in more detail, our next speaker is our traffic engineer, John Davenport. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is John Davenport, president of John Davenport Engineering. Address is 305 West 4th Street, Winston-Salem, North Carolina. We have nine offices, including one here in the Triangle. Our firm had the pleasure of working on the transportation piece of this project. And just give you a little bit about my background, since it's the first time I've met many of you. I am a graduate of NC State, worked for the Department of Transportation for 10 years before I started this firm in 2002. I like to tell people I served a 10-year sentence with the department and got out with good behavior. So I know a lot of the people with the department, and that's been very beneficial for our firm, and it was in this case, working through the challenges that we had to work through to identify the right-of-way. We worked with staff, we worked with NCDOT, and you have the results in your package that we were able to get the answers that everyone needed to make sure this project could go forward. And I'll be here to answer any other questions you have, but I'll cede the rest of my time to the other speakers.
Thank you. The next speaker is Tony Fisher.
Good evening, Mayor Bell and members of the City Council. I'm going to be brief in my comments, and I won't use my 3 minutes either. My name is Tony Fisher, and I'm the president of University Ford and University Kia. I've been working at University Ford for 29 years. I even go to church downtown, so I've been downtown most every day for the last three decades. I'm proud of what's happening downtown, and I think what you're considering tonight is not only important to University Ford and University Kia, I think it's important to the future revitalization, continued revitalization of our city. Now, in my opinion, the process and the pathway our team took to get to this vote tonight has been unreasonably long and unreasonably expensive. However, I think that they have answered every question and every concern that they've been confronted with, and I think they've done it more than satisfactorily. Certainly, this zoning will be good for our company. It'll be good for our employees, it'll be good for our customers, but again, this rezoning is good for Durham. And since I am so convinced that this is one of those classic win-win scenarios, I have no doubt that I'm doing the right thing when I ask you to vote for approval. Thank you.
The next and final speaker is Michael Waldrop.
I will try to be very brief. Michael Waldrop, 5324 McFarland Road. I am a neighbor of the future University Ford. We support this. I wanted to convey that message. I view them, if you have a long enough time horizon, I view this as a future block in the Patterson Place compact neighborhood as it evolves over time. So I wanted to indicate, as I've done privately with some of you, that we look very favorably upon this, and with some of the initiatives that are underway with the city, with compact neighborhood definition, with the LRT EIS process that's underway, I think this will be a very valuable part of that future neighborhood in time. Not necessarily as a car dealership, I'm looking beyond that at a second generation redevelopment of the site. But if you have a long enough time horizon, this makes sense and we support it as their neighbors. So we urge you to vote yes on this.
Is there anyone else that wants to speak on this item? This being a public hearing. If not, let the record reflect that no one else asked to speak. I'll bring the matter back before the council for comments. Recognize Councilwoman Cotati, Councilwoman Moffitt, in that order.
Thank you, Mayor. I actually wanted to hear from transportation staff, but just initially, I just wanted to say I appreciate the comments, but I will say that I'm looking at this as a land use rezoning and not about the merits of moving business from one location to another. I just think that we need to keep it in that context. Mr. Judd, can you talk just briefly about the realignment, I shouldn't say realignment, the elimination of the loop and what Durham DOT's feeling is about this, given the long horizon of the improvements on 15501, or any other transportation concerns. I'll leave it at that.
Yeah. Bill Judge with City Transportation. The one of the attachments in your packet showed the from the adopted corridor study, sort of Cloverleaf interchange. Early on in the process, we met with the applicant because of the impacts and that it would essentially be almost a taking of their parcel. And we discussed with them the process that they would need to go through in order to consider an alternative interchange, and that it would have to basically have no impact on other property owners. They couldn't shift it to where other property owners would be negatively impacted, and that it would have to be something that would be deemed, I guess, viable or acceptable to NCDOT, since this is two state roads and would likely be a future state TIP project, even though there's, as they indicated, there are no right-of-way or corridor protection acts or anything. So a lot at the Planning Commission, they when this got before them, they still did not have NCDOT's concurrence. That came in Friday at about lunchtime, where NCDOT finally agreed to this alternative interchange that you saw in your packet today. So at this point, we don't really have any further comments about it.
Okay. I guess my only other question was in the memo on page 5 of 18. I guess transportation staff noted that the applicant's revised concept eliminates access to 15501 at Mount Moriah Road. Can you comment on that? That I didn't understand.
Yes.
That exactly.
And under the functional design that they prepared, they're showing Mount Moriah being grade separated, with a bridge over Mount Moriah to get from one side to the other. Our concern there was that a number of property owners have invested under the previous concept. It had basically a service road configuration where the north and south side had right in, right out access. So knowing that there hadn't been any sort of public hearings or public vetting of that, we did have some concerns of as that potential impact to those property owners.
And would you anticipate that when North Carolina DOT actually does finalize plans for the 15501 corridor, that there would be public hearings and
yes,
further input?
Yes, there would have to be a series of public hearings. And I guess I should point out that DOT would consider, I guess, all, any and all concepts as part of their environmental document. So even though the applicant, they've signed off on the applicant's alternative design, it doesn't necessarily mean that that'll be the one that gets constructed.
Right. Thank you so much. So just back to my prior point about land use, again, what's before us is a rezoning from RS20, so residential suburban, to commercial general, and I do, in fact, think that makes sense. And I would also concur that I have concerns about density for a future light rail station, but as Mr. Waldrop noted, I think we should be looking long-term about possible second-generation redevelopment of that site. Thanks.
Thank you. I recognize Councilman Moffitt. Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I would like to ask our city attorney, in terms of Mr. Biker talked earlier about the potential liability of the city, given our UDO and the, you know, what's incorporated there. Do you agree with him that we would not have liability in this situation? I guess the current configuration is included in the Metropolitan Planning document and so forth.
Thank you, Councilman Shule. And you know, if you ask me a question about whether or not we will or will not have liability, I'll never quite answer it the way that you want me to. But I will say this: we have spoken with the applicant and the applicant's attorneys. We are not concerned that you're taking any undue risk taking this particular action. We feel confident that it's within your jurisdiction and your authority to do so.
And thank you. And so my next question is also related to transportation, Mr. Judge. So in your professional opinion or your best estimate, can you give us a range of when you think, when you look into your crystal ball, when we might see, how many years are we talking about before 15501? There's actual work on turning that into a limited access highway.
There's been a series of interim improvements that have already been made in the number of years since that corridor study was developed. Mainly the six laning provided some interim capacity. In the current state transportation improvement program, they do have a project scheduled for doing some environmental work for the Garrett Road and Garrett Road interchange. So, I mean, it's subject to funding and availability, but it seems to be scoring well. So we would think that we're hoping that it won't be another 20 years, I guess. That would be closer to sooner than that, but it's certainly not anything that's currently funded either.
Okay. But I think what you're saying is it's sort of being done gradually. It's being done piece by piece.
Yes.
Already. Yeah. So what would be done at Garrett Road, would there be some sort of limited access at Garrett Road at that point?
Yes, the Garrett Road would also have a future interchange, and as part of that study, we're hopeful that maybe DOT will go ahead and, since there's really not that much distance, that they'll maybe go ahead and do all the environmental work together all the way down the I-40. But at this point, they have not started that work, so really can't give you any definitive answers.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Mr. Mayor, I may have some comments in a minute, but those are my questions. Thank you.
Well, let me ask, are there other comments or questions?
I was about to move the item.
Do you want to make your comments now, Steve? You want to make it after the
motion? Yes.
Okay. Is there a motion on this item?
I would like to move the plant. Let me ask this. Did the staff's recommendation change?
It did, Councilman Cole McFadden. Previously were unable to determine compliance with a number of policies in a comprehensive plan that pertained to transportation improvements. But with NCDOT's letter from last Friday, we were able to determine compliance. So we now can bring you, what's before you is consistent with the comprehensive plan, in our opinion.
So I'd like to move the staff's recommendation.
Second.
It's been properly moved and second. Recognize Councilman Shule.
Mr. Mayor, I'm going to vote for this, but I do want to say I'm not totally comfortable with it, and I do want to say my reasons. Let's just say that the state DOT's Joey Hopkins letter is a weak endorsement. the concept appears to manage the forecasted traffic on, seems to fit within the offered wider way. It's the farthest thing from a full endorsement, and so I think that, you know, we have to be clear what we're doing here on that. And I understand the staff's continuing concerns about the SPUI concepts' impacts, because there are these other people who've already have developments out there, and there I can, you know, what you described about the right in, right out expectations are something that I think are important. The reason that I feel comfortable with it, on the other hand, enough to vote for it, is that I think this is all very much in the future. We don't know what the configuration will actually be here. The city's not at risk for it if there is another decision made. But I do think it's, you know, I do want to say for, and Mr. Waldrop's point about this being, you know, down the road, so to speak, you know, it may, you know, 20 years from now, this may be something very different. But I do think that for the landowner, you know, this is something that is out there, and you're doing this with full awareness of that. But I'm a little uncomfortable, but I'm going to vote for it, and I just wanted to say my thoughts on that, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Well, I was going to wait until after the vote, but I'll go ahead and make my comments now. I plan to vote for this item, and Patrick raised two questions. Patrick Biker raised two questions when he began his comments. One was relative to the city attorney's position. I had asked the developers when they met with me that I wanted to have some assurance that the city would not assume any liability if we chose to move forward with this. And you've heard the developer's attorney, and you heard our city attorney didn't quite say for sure, but I got the gist of what he was saying. He was in agreement with that. The other question that Patrick asked, were we ready for University Ford to move? I was ready for University Ford to move in 1994 when I was chairman of the Board of County Commissioners, and we had a bond referendum, and we were going to build the ballpark where University Ford was. So I've been ready since 1994. So. And answer your question, Patrick. So having said that, I'm going to call the vote. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? You close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. Let's move to the next item. We need the consistency statement. It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We move to item 25, street closing, Beeman Street, street closing 15-00004.
Thank you again, Mr. Mayor, members of council, Pat Young with the Planning Department. This item, SC 15-00004, Beeman Street closing, is a request by Mike Tarrant on behalf of Stewart Engineering to close 422 linear feet of Beeman Street, which is a currently open right-of-way, reflects the entirety of Beeman Street. This right-of-way is bordered by property owned by the City of Durham and Gethsemane Baptist Church. If the request is approved, the right-of-way will be divided evenly among these adjoining property owners, as reflected in the street closing plat with your item. The area adjacent to this right-of-way is bordered by a place of worship and vacant land proposed for development. If approved, the property owned by the city would be developed as part of the Southside Redevelopment Project with residential units. The request was reviewed by 19 city and county departments and utility service providers, and no negative impacts were identified by these review agencies. Staff recommends approval, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. This is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. The questions by members of the council of the staff report. If not, we had one person that wanted to speak, Mike Tarrant, and he said he wanted to speak in case of questions only, but come to the podium.
Good evening, Mayor Bell, Madam Pro Tem, members of the City Council. I'm Mike Tarrant with Stewart. I reside at 2205 Caroline Drive. As you mentioned, Mayor Bell, I'm here just to accept any questions should they arise. I don't have any comments on this matter, but would appreciate your support in the second phase of Southside.
All right, thank you. Are there any questions of the representative? If not, any questions of members of the audience? Let reflect that no one wanted to speak publicly on this item beyond the representative. I declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Okay, before I close out, let me ask, are there other items that the council has questions on or comments on? Oh, we have to do a consistency statement on this. Did we do that?
No, we didn't have to do that.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, I've got one more item. I'm trying to get out here before 8 o'clock. Okay, sorry about that. 26, okay, economic development.
Mr. Mayor, I didn't know you'd taken a skipping items.
I don't normally, but we need to deal with this one, right? Okay, economic development incentive agreement between Longfellow Real Estate Partners, LLC, and the City of Durham.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, council members, staff, and members of the public. I'm Kevin Dick, Director of the Office of Economic and Workforce Development. I appreciate the privilege this evening to present a proposed economic development incentive agreement between the City of Durham and Durham ID Phase 1 Developers, LLC. I'd also like to acknowledge the presence of a representative from Durham ID Phase 1, Ms. Jessica Brock, and she may have comments for you before the item is closed. Jessica works for Longfellow Real Estate Partners, LLC, which is the parent company for Durham ID Phase 1. Longfellow acquires and develops facilities in strategic locations, building long-term life science companies, long-term life science companies, universities, medical centers, and research institutes. Four notable projects in Durham to date have been the Carmichael Building and Research Lab, as well as Royal Center and Exchange Place. Longfellow has also contributed $260,000 locally to education and workforce initiatives, namely to the Duke Talent Identification Program, Durham Technical Community College, and the Office of Economic and Workforce Development. And this has been a very significant contribution to our career pathway and Durham youth work efforts. And so we're greatly appreciative of what they've contributed. And their contributions have been focused on STEM industries. So they're really trying to connect young people and provide the resources for local agencies to connect young people to high growth and high wage jobs. The project would consist of $87 million of capital investment and completion of other deliverables by 2019, and should yield $7.6 million in incremental property taxes to the city over a 15-year period. The proposed incentive payment would be $5.25 million, yielding a net revenue amount of over $2.3 over that 15-year period. New construction along Morris Street would create a strategically located infill development and enhance the Central Park District. And I do want to bring up a few renderings. Illustrate the project. The first rendering will illustrate the entire development. What's under consideration this evening is just phase one. It's taking a bit longer to come up than expected. But this, the entire project is basically seen over a 15-acre site that has an eastern terminus along Morris Street and a western terminus at Duke Street. As I said earlier, the Carmichael Building has already been developed, and that forms the western terminus. And what is under consideration this evening would be the C1, C2, and P1. And I will zoom in on those a bit. And so basically in the center part of the screen, would be the P1 would be a structured parking deck. C1 would be office and lab space, as would C2, and these are both along Morris Street. And so to go into the remainder of the presentation, as I said earlier, $87 million in capital investment and completion of other deliverables by 2019. And so no performance payments or incentive payments would be paid until that is fully realized. And that's very significant because it basically mitigates the risk that the city would have. Durham ID Phase 1 tenants are anticipated to generate as many as 850 new permanent highways jobs, with an additional 2,000 in future phases. The job mix would include scientific, technical, and administrative, as well as research and development positions. And an additional 783 positions are estimated in terms of temporary construction. In terms of policy issues, capital investment in the science and technology industry are very much in line with our economic development incentive policy, as well as our joint economic development strategic plan. The project involves a strong collaboration with Duke University and Measurement Incorporated. It would create flexible environments, cutting-edge lab space, and mixed-use opportunities. And as I said, would also be consistent with policy. This project would make Durham more internationally competitive in recruiting life sciences companies. There are other areas that Durham is in competition with nationwide and internationally. And currently, there are over 80 innovation districts internationally. And so just as the Business Improvement District was improved a few years ago by council, that would help embolden and strengthen downtown. We believe that this project would do something similar. And I use that specific reference because there were roughly 82 downtowns in the country that had business improvement districts, and there are roughly 80 innovation districts internationally, and Durham would be adding one. And as I mentioned earlier, there's strong consistency with the Joint Economic Development Strategic Plan, specifically the provision about live, work, play clusters. And this particular phase would include the work part of it, and future phases would include the live and play parts. The city incentive would be $5.25 million paid over 15 years. The county incentive is projected to be $2.5 million over 5 years. The remaining project capital would likely come from equity investment. As I said earlier, the incentives would be performance-based, meaning that no incentives would be paid until after a certificate of occupancy is generated, and at no point during the incentive period would there be any negative cash flow. Condition precedents, there would be the inclusion of a workforce plan stipulating the use of the NC Works Career Center to recruit recruit temporary construction jobs. There would also be the inclusion of a Durham-based business plan promoting the use of Durham-based contractors, including minority and women-owned contractors, and goals have been set relative to this item. There would also be the availability of a percentage of parking for public use on nights and weekends. There would be provision of a green space that would be accessible by the public. That would be known as Morris Green. And incentive payments would be subject to project delivery, as I said earlier, and the verification of capital investment. Why is an incentive necessary? The $5.25 million in city investment is needed to make this project feasible in Durham, because laboratory space development often requires greater investment than other commercial or office development types. The project must rely on self-contained parking, requiring new structured parking construction, and market dynamics related to parking in downtown are in such a way that incentives would be needed to get entire projects completed that rely upon the need for parking. A competitive market rate of return on investment is required to capitalize the project. And finally, the project would create desperately needed Class A office space downtown. Currently, our vacancy rate is 6%. And anecdotally, we know that we are losing projects in downtown because of the lack of office space. This project would bring about new development, would also increase property tax revenue. It would attract high-tech laboratory and office tenants, creating highways jobs and growing industry sectors. The additional service industry workers would also be needed as highways jobs increase, so transitional job opportunities could be created for Durham residents as well. And the anticipated revenues for would far exceed proposed maximum public investment. That concludes my presentation. I'll welcome any questions or comments at this time.
Thank you. Let me ask other questions. The Mayor Pro Tem, Councilman Brown, Councilman Shule, Councilman Cotati, in that order.
Thanks, Kevin, for all the work you've done. Who will monitor the MWBE SDBE participation on the project?
That would be monitored by the Office of Economic and Workforce Development. We would get quarterly reports from the development team.
Is North Carolina Central University involved with this at all? I noticed a collaboration with Duke.
Right. We have connected the developer with North Carolina Central. We've actually were able to facilitate a tour of the Bright Center. Mm-hmm. And so much of the lab space that's in the Bright Center would mimic and therefore prepare a lot of students for possible opportunities. And there have been good discussions, I believe, with the university and with the developer about different ways that collaboration can take place in the future.
Well, I'd like some more details about that. Some sort of commitment from him, from the developer, if that's possible.
Okay. That's Councilman Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Kevin, you noted that this was the plan that you presented this evening was for phase one?
Correct.
Can you tell us a little bit about phase two or three? And would this be included under the umbrella?
Would this be included?
Yeah, would phase two and three also be included under what you outlined this evening?
The proposed incentive is for phase one. Any considerations of future phases in terms of public involvement would need to be assessed by staff if they were brought to us and then further approved by council. So this, I would say that, and I'm bringing up the rendering again of what may be phases, future phases. What we know according to the developer is that the second phase would likely be the C4 and C3 buildings, and so these would likely be office space and lab space as well, and then there would be residential uses in future phases, but phase two is likely to be C3 and C4, with phase three coming in future phases in the northern end of the development.
Could you give us an estimate of the timeline involved here?
The projected timeline thus far would be roughly 7 year, a 7 year development period. for all of the phases. Jessica Brock from Longfellow is here to provide any more clarity or details related to that. But in our discussions with the developer to this point, we've been told that all phases should be completed in the 7 to 9 year time frame.
Okay, so what you're telling us then, and maybe Ms. Brock can educate us on this, but that we could be sitting here, not myself, but we could be, the council could be here even 3 or 4 years hence and undergoing this yet another incentive plan?
There's been no determination to this point that Longfellow would present another proposed incentive or request for incentives to staff. So I can't say that is impossible, but I wouldn't say that it is imminent either.
Well, then, of course, the council could also reject that.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
I should have indicated early on that this is a public hearing, so all the comments have been made are part of the public hearing. I recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Kevin, the open space on attachment 8, exhibit DID rendering 2 open space.
Correct.
How does that, I actually know that you've told us this before, I think when we first talked about this, maybe in closed session, but how does that relate to the buildings? Where are the buildings? It's hard for me to figure that out from the putting the two renderings together.
So phase one, the buildings would be along Morris Street.
Yeah.
Phase one, the open space, what's known as Morris Green, would be within this blue square.
Yeah.
And so that essentially would be across the street and slightly to the...
to the west.
The west and north.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I see. Yeah, all right. So, okay, now I get it. Okay, thank you.
Sure.
I think that's my only question right now, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Recognize Councilwoman Cotardi.
Yeah, Kevin, I wanted to ask if you could detail what the $8.3 million in public infrastructure in the vicinity that's noted on page 2 of the memo.
So generally speaking, there would be improvements along Fernway Avenue, sidewalk improvements, various infrastructure improvements, believe some lighting elements. But Jessica, if you want to come forward and provide more detail.
Hi, I'm Jessica Brock with Longfellow. Some of the additional infrastructure is burying some power lines, widening the streets, adding bike lanes, increasing the size of the water retention system as necessary. For the phase one, it's outlined as $8.3 million.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, I have comments later after the speakers, if you don't mind.
Any other comments by members of the council? We only have two persons that have signed up to speak on this item. Victoria Peterson and Vince Taylor, in that order. Each have 3 minutes.
And somebody...
The lights go off over there for the timer?
No, mine's not.
And?
And how many minutes, Mr.
Three.
Mayor?
Three.
Okay. Thank you. I would just like to talk to the council for a few minutes. I have not really spoken a lot on this issue to make sure that our young men in this community are being employed. And I know Ms. Giles, Ms. Deborah Giles, and I know she's been trying to do the best job she can to make sure that minority companies get employment. I think that there needs to be another level, Mr. Barnfield. I think the city really seriously needs to look at how are we making sure that our young men in this community, black, white, particularly our African-American young men who have criminal records, but their criminal records were years ago, and they, over the years, they have gotten themselves together, and they need employment. And many times these companies, it sounds good what my friend is saying, but we really do not have anyone in place to make sure that our citizens, regardless if they have a company or not, or regardless if they are subcontracting their sales out, we need to put something in place, council members, to make sure that our citizens are being employed, particularly our young black men, Mr. Davis, and I call him Mr. Davis because numerous times he has an educational background, and he worked in this system with our young men and women. He knows the importance of our young men and women getting employment. I think when the city gives a lot of our dollars out, even to this new police station, we need to put something in place. We need to hire somebody that can come back and give the city a report that we have hired 50 young men in this community for jobs on this site, not just North Carolina Central University. And I think that's great, and I think that's good. But there's a huge population in this community that is not getting employment. And these are our young men and women who have criminal records, and they are falling through the cracks. They get stressed out, and they go out, and they continue to commit crime. And Mr. Mayor, if we're going to sign off on this project, we've got to put something in place. The only way to do that is to really hire one or two persons, and their job would be every project that the city signs off on, they make sure that our Durham residents are first being employed. Not folks coming in from California, from Texas, from Timbuktu. And Mr. Mayor, thank you very much for allowing me to speak. But please, we've got to put something in place here to make sure that our local residents are being employed. And thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Next is Vince Taylor.
Good evening, Mayor. Mayor Pro Tem, City Attorney, City Manager, and City Council. Thank you all so much for your energy that you put into this fair seat of ours. My name is Vince Taylor. I live at 2915 43 Heights, which I'm the president of the community, but I'm also an active member of PAC 4. I have great concerns about this particular project, and also as a small contractor, the owner of Taylor's Construction Company, did a lot of work in the city of Durham. I would like to just also say that please, if there's any way possible, and I come this evening with an olive branch, let's find ways that I have so many young men that call me on a daily basis and say, Mr. Taylor, do you have a job for me? They are so passionate about it. And I know because I deal with these type of people. I just want to try to find ways that we can try to employ. I mean, just reach in there and try to get a little bit more out of our community. I'm also an active member of a school called CET. I teach and train young men and women trades, all different types. And they also want to make transition into our communities by way of employment. Now, I come this evening as a well from olive branch. Please, let us try to find ways to employ some of the ones who have been disenfranchised. And I don't need a whole bunch of time to make that plea to y'all. And thank you all so much for your time.
You're welcome. Council said you wanted to wait until you hear from the public. Let me ask, is anyone else in the public that wants to speak on this item that has not had an opportunity to speak? If not, I recognize the members of the council. Councilwoman Catani.
Thank you, Mayor. I just had a few comments. I appreciate that since we saw this in June that you have made the commitment for parking availability on nights and weekends for 50%. Of the spaces, and I do think that this is a good project and a development, but as I said in June, I still believe that an incentive equivalent to 70% of future tax revenues is just too high, so for that reason, I'll be voting against it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments by members of the council? Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I did want to point out, and with appreciation to our city attorney's office and also to the Office of Economic and Workforce Development, that this is our first incentive where we have some assurances by the company of appropriate treatment of contractors and lower tier subcontractors. And this is a good addition to, you know, we know the recent situation at the Residence Inn, and we don't want a repeat of that. I don't know that this totally changes the possibility that there will be a repeat of that, but I do think that this is an advance, and appreciate that very much. And Kevin, didn't know if you wanted to comment on that at all. Any thoughts on that? Okay. I would like you to comment on, again, about the employment plan, because we have one. You've described it, but we've heard a couple people here who want to hear more, I think. So could you describe in a little bit more detail what we do and how we do it?
Certainly, Councilman Shule. We have a Durham workforce plan that is part of the agreement. It's an attachment to the agreement. And what we do is connect the subcontractors to the NC Works Career Center system. We try to set up a pipeline of individuals that are completing training programs and or those who already have experience in the various construction fields that would be part of the development of this project. And basically what we do is connecting with opportunity. There were some statements made and comments about the need to guarantee that certain individuals get employed. And as much as we want to derive the maximum economic development benefits of this project that would be possible, we can't guarantee that individuals get hired by law. But what we can do is connect people with the best opportunities. We can invite subcontractors, which we have done in the past, to our recruitment events for recruitment events and graduation events for various training classes. That has been effective with various training programs that we've run out of NC Works, and we do the best job that we can in trying to connect people with opportunity. We can't guarantee hires, and we can't walk into interviews with individuals that are interviewing for positions. The best we can do is prepare and connect with opportunity, and then the process has to flow as it does.
So for Mr. Taylor, who works with a lot of young people who are seeking jobs in construction and the trades, how would you ask him to advise them in terms of connecting with this project?
We'd keep Mr. Taylor and other construction companies like his, and also, you know, Mr. Taylor does an outstanding job of volunteering at one of our local institutions. We would just keep them apprised of when we expect certain positions to be available. And we are also going to stay in very close contact with the developer when they choose a general contractor. So that flow of communication can occur between the general contractor and their subs and our training programs. And we have a staff person assigned to make sure that flow of communication happens.
Thank you very much. I guess, Mr. Mayor, you want to comment now? Or just?
I'm going to make a comment, but okay. You have another comment you want to make?
I'd have one.
Go ahead and make it.
Yeah. I think that, you know, I know that I almost hesitate to make this again because it haven't had much success with it, but I do want to point out again the county's extremely large benefit relative to ours. Tax benefit as opposed to the size of the incentive that we're offering. And I hope that we will continue to be working on that, trying to get it down to where, in my opinion, it's more reasonable, at least at the 50-50 level. I agree with Diane that this is a large incentive percentage, and it's a close call. I am going to vote for it, but I understand the point she's making. It's an important one. And we need to try to keep beating the percentages of these down as downtown becomes more popular. And so I hope you all be working to that end. Thank you.
I guess my comments are, I support the project. That's the start. But I really, we've heard this bit about minority employees, subcontractors, the work that the city's going to do, how you walk with the people and all this stuff. But this stuff starts at the top. And I really would like to hear a commitment from the developers in terms of what is your response to doing all that you can do to ensure that minority contractors have an opportunity to work on this project. It starts at the top. I mean, you guys are going to ultimately make the call who the general contractor is. I know you can tell people what you want, and whether or not they want to adhere to it, that's a different issue. Then you've got to come make a decision. But I really would like to hear from Longfellow. What is your commitment to this?
So Longfellow is committed to making sure that the jobs are filled by Durham residents. We have a contractual obligation that is in our development agreement, but we have not hired any general contractors or subs. In fact, we've interviewed several consultants in the area to actually help us with this, to help us identify who are good minority or women-owned businesses that can be a part of our project. So. If what you want to hear from Longfellow, from me, is that we are committed to that, we're absolutely committed to that. And I think at the end of the project, we'll look back at it because we'll track it, and we'll be proud of the results that we were able to deliver. And I just want to thank the City Council for, considering this transformational project for downtown Durham.
All right. Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Yeah. Recognize the Mayor Pro Tem.
Yeah, I mentioned working with North Carolina Central University and just wanted to know your plans are.
I'm sorry, and I meant to address that when I came back up here, but I have had the pleasure of working with Dr. Sanders White already. She has come and toured the Carmichael, and we have been in early discussions about how can Central be a part of this. I'll tell you that her plans are big plans, not plans that will be in the next 6 to 12 months, but how can, what impact can Central have on an innovation district, whether it's within my 15 acres exactly, or if it's a part of greater downtown that this development then spurs.
In your development and how you, I understand you're going to be doing some collaboration with Duke. And that's why I raised the question about North Carolina Central, the other school in town.
Right.
Okay.
Are there any other comments? If not, the public hearing is closed. The matter is before the council. Entertain a motion on item.
I'd like to move the item.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Further discussion. Hearing none, call the question. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote and close the vote?
It passes 6-1 with Councilman Makatadi voting no.
Thank you. Let me ask, are there other items to come before the council? I have one other item that I'm going to raise. Recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I see we have a lot of officers and former officers here, and I don't know exactly why they're here, but I can guess. And so I want to say two things. One is, I know that the whole council is fully supportive of the department and is looking forward to moving forward with a great future for our department. And we appreciate everything that you do. We appreciate the work that you do on the street every day, every night, and we're glad you're here. The second thing I want to say is this to you all. My wife is out of town, and I'm going out for pizza afterwards across the street. I won't invite all of you, but if some of you would like to come join me and talk about the concerns that you're here to make available, I will be there, and you can join me in the pizza. I'm not buying. Chief Peter, Chief Mahiach, Mr. Wiggins, if any of you or a couple of others would like to come, I will be there and happy to listen. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Well, the last, I'm running the meeting. I'm running the meeting. Thank you. All right. The last point that I was going to raise, we did have one person that has signed up to speak. People have been sitting here all night, and of course, I was getting ready to go at 8 o'clock, but we had another item. So I'm going to call on Michael Evans for 3 minutes, if Michael Evans is still here. Thank you.
Mayor Bell, Pro Tem Mayor, City Council. I'm Mike Evans. I'm the president of Fraternal Police. We've got approximately 500 members.
A little bit more to the mic.
And
Peterson, I have told you, I don't know how many times, I'm running the meeting. This is the last person that's going to speak. Mr. Evans, will you go ahead and, I'm going to ask you to leave the audience. I've heard you. Mr. Evans, go ahead.
We're here to show support for Chief Lopez. We felt like he was done wrong. They was told that we were going to get a new chief because morale was low and that the crime rate went up. We did a little research. The crime rate is actually now, we went back to 1994. The crime rate is the lowest with him of the last four chiefs. He supports us, and we felt if you would support the chief and the department the way he supports us, that we would not be having the problems we are right now. The times we're living in are bad. It's bad all over the United States, and I think it's time that the community and the police department work together. And that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
That concludes the meeting this evening. If there's no further comments, the meeting's adjourned at 8:30 p.m. Thank you.